Dag fas een tiger kelters na nogedi, barre ni smo fi akna meert na helen, na beg nach een tier helle. Bein fas bewoze tier, le ra hied blien. Hug een re nuasha, du laan agus deshena de hummel luchtes gael, gehadehe kon a spation fabule gemaats na klahi, en mask dine a vini sophisticule, agus nis gnohi na riev. Chaurig tús maan na nóchadí do, nur a bhuaig corcig an chréamh dúbalte, pell agus amáint, le Teddy McCarty ag imirt ar an dá éirin. Sa bhliain chéana áfach, fuair Italia 90 gráim ar gachéine, agus bé an sacr a bhí a méal an phobl.
Stands and terraces confirming once again the enduring attraction of Dublin Meath clashes. Rarely, if ever, has a first round match captured such attention. The referee is Tommy Howard from Kildare for this battle of the champions.
I remember after Italia 90, everybody said, oh, the GAA is dead. And suddenly, you had a preliminary round in 1991, you had Meath and Dublin. And you had four probably the most extraordinary matches, you know, that everybody was talking Gaelic again. It wasn't a penalty shootout. Do you know what I mean? It was to the death, as the saying goes, you know. You marvelled at the way it captured the imagination. You know, people came from America, fellas who would come home maybe for the All-Ireland every year. They got on planes and they came home. People came home from England. They came just to be there.
It all began on June the 2nd, and here we are in the first week of July, and this issue still not resolved.
Pulling in goal. He's denied Dublin in the past. Can he now keep Meath in this championship match? It's a goal! No, it's outside! It's outside! He's missed it! Keith Barr has missed the penalty! Beggy. It's still possible. Foley. Into Gillick. A lot of poor marking by Dublin. And it's Tommy Downes has got it right through the heart to Foley! I don't believe it! They're level. 50 seconds to go, and Kevin Foley. Oh, they're going for a win, which we scarcely thought they were going to have 10 minutes ago. We had them completely written off.
And they have a chance, and the right man have it now, Flynn.
Kicking, and they're in front. Meath lead in this amazing. They've won it. Meath have won by a point.
When the fourth match is over and the devastation with the Dublin players, and I'd have to say there wasn't an ego in the Meath dressing room, because at the end of it, after 247 minutes, you know, you had won by a point, and it could so easily, probably should have gone the other way, or maybe gone to another replay or whatever. But again, they're the things that come along to lift your spirit and you know, drive it on and say, these are great games, you know. We have a huge tradition, you know, that we have to care for and mind and pass on.
Jack Lynch once said that hurling typifies the Irish character and temperament more than anything else, with the exception of our language. And I think very few would disagree with that. And I love what Carberry said about hurling. He said, hurling survives and is indestructible because of its stern, naked grandeur.
I have such a craving for thee, O Donlough, because you praise my days with hurling deeds. When you make leaps with your back to the goals, plucking high balls out of teeming skies to hurl them low between the posts. Deeds alone are certain good. 3:15 p.m. Sunday afternoon in the bar of the Sleevemore Hotel, on the side of the flapping mountain, pegged down in cloud. Red-eyed with grief, perched on a high stool at the bar, I am staring up into a blank screen. Will nobody switch it on? The TV up there on its black bracket? Have I come out in vain in the gale and the rain? Do none of you here believe in the All-Ireland hurling final between Tipperary and Clare? If I ask, If I ask the man behind the bar to switch on the television, will he? My skepticism stutters. He'll not. He smiles, a barman's Japanese smile. Pictures, a light on the screen, like birds on the bough. The woods of Crow Park are alive.
I think one can use any word one likes. You can talk about a crisis or a renaissance in the 90s. I wouldn't use either word. And the reason is this. Down the decades from 1900, the same 12 teams have been contesting All-Ireland finals. And even when you begin to analyse that, what you come up with is three superpowers. Cork, Kilkenny, Tipperary. At the lower end of that 12, I would have Antrim, Dublin and Laois, and then in between, you have the remaining six. Offaly, Wexford, Galway, Waterford, Clare and Limerick. Each of those have had a golden era. Each of those have periods when they dominated.
Bíochar bhuaig na cóchtaí múra, Corcaig, Cílchine agus Tobardárn, Clévacha a dús na nóchadí, hasna cléhe canis naidu gnócha cair, idir Limenach agus Íváile, tréifse for lávish da chuntahe ele. Sa chléhe sin, bhí Limenach cúl chúdíní chun tosig, le chéri nómat fáca, mar a has Johnny Dooley os cún na lirhóide. Bhí tróirige ón Dave Líne cúlíín a hógult.
Going for a goal, and he's got it! That's exactly what Offaly require, and what the game has needed. Offaly now feeling that they can turn the tide. But O'Connor's in! It's another one!
Tevishtig the Cherin Omut, agus Cherin Second Diog, Daim Shidr, Dole Akulig.
There's Johnny Dooley. Is that a point? It certainly is. As Billy Dooley fires in another beauty. It's just like routine practice now. Back again to Billy Dooley. Nobody marking him. And that's three in a row.
Hitchcock, he must have written the script. Because it's the only script that could fit what happened. But often they have a temperament, and I've often said this, they have a calm, cool temperament where they never get flustered. And even though they appeared to have that game lost, even though they were out hurled certainly for most of the game, they finished up with this calm temperament that took the opportunity when it came and won an All-Ireland title that they didn't appear capable of winning.
Bhí Íváile ar thuair an dara craobh as a chéile nuair a chasadar ar an gláir nach raibh craobh buataicha ó néidir go ceardaíoch.
Technically, Clare and Wexford weren't as good as some of the teams that were playing. They were not. That's it. That's a given. They weren't as good technically as the likes of Kilkenny and Cork. So they had to come in and be able to do things a bit differently. And that meant that the level of fitness had to be brought up. And we certainly realised in our time that if we weren't up to a savagely high standard ourselves, that there's no way we could compete.
Next, it's Gary Laffan against two Limerick men. Knocked in there. Larry Murphy's in there challenging Tom Dempsey as well. And it's a goal for Wexford. And Tom Dempsey scored.
Every time when we got to a big match and we lost these 13 finals, everyone kept saying, oh, it's only a game. No, go out and think it's only a game. That's only a few words. That's no help to anybody. So what we decided to do was to say, this is much bigger than a game. This is about a way of life. And so we had a few words and we swore that we wouldn't set foot back in Wexford without that cup this time. Because enough was enough.
Champion. performance of passion, of bravery, of skill, of tactics by the manager. And this is what Martin Storey has dreamed about. The team of 68 can take a back seat. It's now about the men of 96.
Hurlers of Tipperary and Clare are warming up in the goals like young fillies at Ascot, at the starting gate prancing, all halters, all helmets. For 70 deluged minutes, I do not budge from my stool. I roost on my stool, making faces at the screen, big faces, little faces, at each orbit of the earth trajectory of the ball, catch, cut, hook, puck, double, solo, hop. These are the boys who are born to sweeten and delight, to bejewel and beautify. I laugh, I gasp, I frown. At the final whistle, I jump down to my feet, hug myself. I stride over to the TV. I stand under its black bracket, gazing up at the great Loch Nan, being interrogated after the game. Tears alight in my eyes as I listen to him rhapsodize that it was the game that won the game. He cries, "The game of hurling is pure poetry, pure inspiration, pure technique. Hurling won the game today, not Tipperary, not Clare. Today we saw the greatest game of hurling we will ever see." I stride out of the bar into the gale and the rain. Hasten off up into the mountain, bareheaded, open-necked, into the fuchsia, into the mombrisha, into the stick-boss solitudes, as free as a man can ever be. Hurling is the father of freedom. When Jamesy O'Connor, with a minute to go, at full tilt in the middle of the park, pointed for Clare, spacemen on mirror, saw planet Earth fly up out of its tree. The hurler strikes, and man is free.
Hánig peledorí ulla is stachs na nóchadaí le muinín agus passion.
I think down with the, again the team that brought this sense of belief back to Ulster, they had done it 60, 61 and 68, and then there were no All-Irelands in Ulster until they came back again in 1991. And there's a very barren period in that time where there wasn't this sense of belief. People were happy to win Ulster and never really thought they'd go any further.
Again to James McCartan, challenged by Brendan Riley and Kevin Foley, fed inside to Greg Blaney.
Down changed that in 1991 when they regained the Ulster Championship and decided they would go the whole way, and they did, won the All-Ireland again and give a new sense of belief to not only themselves but to all of Ulster.
O'Rourke.
Which is followed then in 92 by Donegal.
History is made. Anthony Molloy, the first Donegal man, to Lipstam. Well, it's a terrific day for all these.
Followed then in 93 by Derry, and down came back again in 94, and I suppose Tyrone felt they let the show down a little bit in 95, because that could have been, you know, a brilliant sort of five in a row for various six Ulster counties. But it didn't happen. But even it didn't happen then, I think it did instill in Ulster football again this sense of respect and sense of belief that they could go the whole way.
Billaghy was a town in mourning today. Shops and businesses closed as this tightly knit community gathered quietly to pay its last respects to a much loved resident.
Ach an anon an ré a bheith a seolta pelle ola, buinag suathe as an bobal a ríist in Melton an 1906, nar a dinag dún varú ar Sean Brown, cahéalach chlub Wolf Tone, béal achig an ré.
There was a perception that we were almost out of the woods. The situation in terms of harassment of members coming to and from games had eased significantly. The Ulster counties themselves had been successful. So those two things were feeding off each other. The general climate and the general mood was certainly more buoyant than it had been. So it had an extremely unsettling effect because of the time at which it occurred, because that was the sort of thing that wasn't supposed to happen anymore.
Achar ranóna saharn gnóhach san ómi, hárla úfás a bhí wad níos mása.
The pallbearers and Philomena Skelton's coffin emerged painfully slowly from the gloom of the chapel and into the daylight. The boys and girls in the guard of honour bowed their heads. In the graveyard almost opposite the Skelton family home, there were many familiar faces. There were the grown-up faces of the boys who had been opponents in the underage football games we used to trek off to on Tuesday nights and wintry Saturday mornings. There were referees, men like Kevin Skelton, who had presided over our first inept steps down the GAA road all those years ago. There were the team managers and the mentors, without whom the GAA would never have become the life force it now was. Men and women from a lifetime steeped in these games, in this small northern corner of the GAA world. After this, they might never be quite the same again. When it was all over, we stood together again in the nearby parish hall, eating sandwiches and cake and drinking milky cups of tea from china cups. And for those few minutes, we had never in our entire lives felt closer or more like GAA people. All of the political problems that the GAA struggled with for the previous 30 years really came home to roost in those weeks and months after the bomb. And you can see it in the different ways in which the association responded to it. The first response, and in my opinion, the wrong response, was to allow hurling championship matches to be played at Croke Park the next day. I think it's inconceivable that if 29 people and unborn twins had been murdered in Dublin or Galway or Limerick, that any GAA games would have been played the following day. I think it's inconceivable.
Series began back in May when we looked forward to a glorious summer, but now we look back on the terrible tragedy of yesterday.
But then, set against that, there was a magnificent response by the GAA hierarchy in terms of expressions of sympathy, attendance at funerals, and expressions of support, and probably most visibly a fact that's lost in a lot of the aftermath of the bomb is that the GAA was the biggest single contributor to the fund that was set up to help the victims and those affected by the bomb.
In 1906, dar de Krishvik Glinan an Leger, nor a harriadur na blienta fada sheleve, tri chreiv ile eirin na glaub a vwakant. Yenir dar a rishte a 1909, an vien kiena gur vertig arim na bretane fu yere tarang tumach as a bark. Se vlien gav ile, vwadar an tiw kaun a gere blienta, agas gien an gashki risht a gav ile gus a shacht.
Passing a cane and the Chibaloidi visa to Eshkert, Eileen and Amazon, Agus Greve, Cross Viglinine, Grouder Sight in the Lower, Agus club special to the header Lee Mar V V Comortis club and Comortis Craven Conte of Wachtin to go August Sunstorm Lake Comortis Pellin club na Hayden go Duxesha Rodegan Ele Spraga Ele Doi Vagas Kimache Le Hele at Nisar Xmayan Tora Ta Trikin Diag the Chrev na Ardvaha Buetico Lahan Nahuede Nielsen came a count all the Haboitica, Agasta, Hirikin, the Hrev, Heron, the Glob Boitica, Sar Rother Fadifshin, the Ain Clubinacher and Aiden. Well, the story of Larna and Nahadi, Gorebe, Eirchdown, good, the Snowfi, Comortis Club, Ach, Storm Gas Park and Croak, Castor Shees, Egenaum. Agus níon sungur í 1968 héin at go gugurach struktúr cart ar an gomórtas. Ach ní himiríach barca chróca gé a lálé a pádar ag gudí 1969 la gribh Nemo Rangers ag gynna Scotstown. Agus an sun lálé a pádar ag bian anime bhír lálé a pádar ag san amach na lán ag lobog barca chróca ag. Agus ó hinne le tá spéis de chlétas a chomórtas agus tá sé fás an táhar fad agus fiúhhain an éidir ag nechanna é bhí slú os ciún de mí an nuir bhfuid cras me glen an lá san láúntacht an globa bethe agus slú úntaché sinna bheitthe ige an chomórtas le le pádra ige an tú chaintinis ar déirin gírig agus slú mar sin thuúla go páir an chrócaig.
Cáim de bhuaic faointín an lochadaí ná athógáil farcan chróchaig, agus an clí go rachas ábalta an stáid a chamad oscailte thar na blianta agus an obair ag dul réig.
They finished it just before they said they were going to finish it. They finished it more or less on budget with some government support, and it's wonderful. And it's one of the things that really adds to the quality of life of this country and was done by an amateur organisation. And it is an extraordinary achievement and an extraordinary reflection of the GAA that they were able to do that. And I mean, you look back at this era of wealth and all that, and Croke Park is the thing that stands out.